Welcome to my video tutorial on gross anatomy of posterior triangle of neck. We will be looking into the following objectives for this topic: location of the posterior triangle, its boundaries, subdivisions of the triangle. For each subdivision, we will be seeing boundaries and contents and few clinical aspects. So let's begin. Location of the posterior triangle of neck. Here is the lateral side of the neck, which is quadrilateral in shape. It is divided diagonally by sternocleidomastoid muscle into two triangles, anterior triangle and posterior triangle, which means posterior triangle lies behind the sternocleidomastoid muscle, which acts like a key muscle in the lateral side of neck. In further slides, we will consider the left-sided posterior triangle to study its features in detail. Posterior triangle of the neck presents following boundaries. In front, it is bounded by posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle. Behind, it is bounded by anterior border of trapezius muscle. Apex lies above where the two muscles meet at superior nuchal line of occipital bone. Base lies below, formed by middle one-third of the clavicle. Here the clavicle acts as an anatomical barrier between posterior triangle and axilla, which means contents of the posterior triangle pass deep to the clavicle to enter into the axilla. Coming to the roof of posterior triangle, it is formed by following structures from outside to inside. They are skin, superficial fascia, which contains loose connective tissue, a thin layer of fat, and a subcutaneous muscle known as platysma. The fibers of platysma are oriented obliquely and covers only the lower and anterior part of the roof of posterior triangle, whereas the rest of the muscle forms the roof of anterior triangle. Deep to the platysma, there lies investing layer of deep cervical fascia. It is the outermost layer of deep fascia of the neck or deep cervical fascia. It splits and encloses sternocleidomastoid in front and trapezius muscle behind and forms the roof of posterior triangle. The part of investing layer forming the roof of posterior triangle is related or pierced by few superficial or cutaneous structures. Let's know about those structures. Here is the investing layer forming the roof of posterior triangle. It is related with few cutaneous veins and nerves. They are external jugular vein. It runs obliquely downwards and backwards across the sternocleidomastoid muscle, lying deep to the platysma. On the roof of posterior triangle, it pierces the investing layer 2.5 cm above the clavicle and enters into lower part of the posterior triangle. On the roof, it receives a major tributary known as posterior external jugular vein, which runs along the posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle and opens into external jugular vein just below its midpoint. Coming to the cutaneous nerves, they pierce the investing layer, run in the superficial fascia and become cutaneous. They are four in number. Lesser occipital nerve. It pierces the investing layer in the upper part of posterior triangle. It ascends along the posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle and supply the skin behind the auricle. Great auricular nerve. It pierces the investing layer at the middle of posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle. It ascends obliquely across the muscle, lying behind and parallel to the external jugular vein. It runs towards parotid region where it divides into branches and supply the skin over the angle of mandible and auricle. Transverse cervical nerve. It lies deep to the investing layer and external jugular vein. It runs horizontally from middle of posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle towards its anterior border, where it pierces the investing layer and become cutaneous to supply the anterior side of the neck. Fourth cutaneous nerve is supraclavicular nerve, which lies deep to the investing layer It descends from the middle of posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle towards clavicle. On its course, it divides into three branches: medial, intermediate, and lateral supraclavicular branches, which pierce the investing layer just above the clavicle and become cutaneous to supply the skin over the chest up to the level of sternal angle and also the skin over the shoulder region. Occasionally, the intermediate branch of supraclavicular nerve may pierce the clavicle. So these are the cutaneous structures related to or piercing the investing layer forming the roof of posterior triangle. They are external jugular vein with its major tributary posterior external jugular vein. Four cutaneous nerves: lesser occipital nerve, great auricular nerve, transverse cervical nerve, and supraclavicular nerve with its three branches. Out of four cutaneous nerves, transverse cervical nerve does not pierce the roof of posterior triangle. Let's identify the cutaneous veins and nerves seen on the roof of posterior triangle in this dissected cadaver. Here is the left posterior triangle of the neck, which is bounded anteriorly by sternocleidomastoid muscle, posteriorly by trapezius muscle. Its apex lies above, at superior nuchal line of the occipital bone. Its base lies below, formed by middle one-third of the clavicle. The cutaneous structures seen on the roof of posterior triangle should be identified by their course in relation with sternocleidomastoid muscle. Here is the external jugular vein, which run obliquely across the muscle, downwards and backwards. Here is the lesser occipital nerve, which ascends along the posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle. Here is the great auricular nerve, which ascends obliquely across the muscle towards parotid region. Here is the transverse cervical nerve, which run horizontally across the muscle towards anterior triangle. Here is the supraclavicular nerve, which descends towards clavicle and divides into three branches: medial, intermediate, and lateral supraclavicular branches. These cutaneous nerves are derived from branches of cervical plexus, which is formed by ventral rami of C2, C3, C4 spinal nerves. Lesser occipital nerve receives root value of C2. Great auricular and transverse cervical nerves share the root value of C2 and C3, whereas supraclavicular nerve root value is C3 and C4. So the roof of posterior triangle is pierced by external jugular vein and cutaneous nerves. The external jugular vein, before it pierces the roof, shows a dilatation known as sinus of the vein. The cutaneous nerves, before they enter onto the roof of posterior triangle, they lie at the middle of posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle. From there, they diverge on the roof of posterior triangle and pierce the investing layer at different points. The roof is also related with superficial cervical lymph nodes, which are grouped at the middle of posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle, from where the cutaneous nerves diverge. Let's quickly revise the structures forming the roof of posterior triangle. From outside to inside, they are skin, superficial fascia with subcutaneous muscle, platysma, which covers only the lower and anterior part of the roof. Deep to that, investing layer of deep cervical fascia, which is related with or pierced by few cutaneous veins and nerves. They are external jugular vein with its tributary posterior external jugular vein. Four cutaneous nerves: lesser occipital nerve, great auricular nerve, transverse cervical nerve, and supraclavicular nerves. They enter onto the roof at the middle of posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle. There, the roof is also related with superficial cervical lymph nodes. Coming to the floor of posterior triangle, the floor is musculofacial. The fascia covering the floor is derived from prevertebral layer of deep cervical fascia. The fascia is supported by underlying neck muscles, which are 6 in number. Let's see the muscles forming the floor of posterior triangle. From above downwards they are semispinalis capitis, splenius capitis, levator scapulae, scalene muscles. There are three scalene muscles: scalenus posterior, scalenus medius, and scalenus anterior. Anterior scalene muscle does not form the floor of posterior triangle as it lies deep to the clavicular head of sternocleidomastoid muscle. So below the middle scalene muscle, floor is formed by first digitation of serratus anterior muscle, which is supported by outer border of first rib. So the six muscles forming the floor of posterior triangle from above downwards are semispinalis capitis, splenius capitis, levator scapulae, posterior scalene, middle scalene, and first digitation of serratus anterior muscles. The highest muscle being semispinalis capitis. It's an occasional muscle to form the floor of posterior triangle. It is identified by its vertically oriented muscle fibers, whereas the rest of the muscles are oriented obliquely, running backwards and downwards. So the floor of posterior triangle is musculofacial. The fascia is derived from prevertebral layer of deep cervical fascia, which is supported by underlying six neck muscles. So that is about the boundaries of posterior triangle of the neck. The points to be understood here are: the roof and the floor are formed by two layers of deep cervical fascia, investing layer and prevertebral layer respectively. The investing layer is related with external jugular vein and four cutaneous nerves along with few superficial cervical lymph nodes. The prevertebral layer is supported by underlying six neck muscles. Moving on to subdivisions of posterior triangle. Lower part of the triangle is traversed by inferior belly of omohyoid muscle. Course of the muscle further divides the posterior triangle into two triangles: upper larger occipital triangle and lower smaller supraclavicular or subclavian triangle. So the inferior belly of omohyoid muscle divides the posterior triangle into further two triangles: upper occipital and lower supraclavicular or subclavian triangles. Let's talk about the omohyoid muscle. It is one of the infrahyoid muscles seen in the neck. It has two muscular bellies: superior belly and inferior belly. Superior belly arises from body of the hyoid bone and descends towards sternocleidomastoid muscle. Inferior belly arises from superior border of the scapula and ascends towards sternocleidomastoid muscle. Both the bellies unite deep to the muscle to form intermediate tendon, which does not have bony attachment. Which means superior belly of the omohyoid seen in the anterior triangle, whereas inferior belly of the omohyoid seen in the posterior triangle of the neck. So it is the inferior belly of omohyoid which divides the posterior triangle into upper occipital triangle and lower supraclavicular or subclavian triangle. The inferior belly lies 2.5 cm above the clavicle, behind the sternocleidomastoid muscle. It is suspended from the clavicle by omohyoid fascia, which may be derived from clavipectoral fascia below or investing layer of deep cervical fascia. The omohyoid fascia lies deep to the investing layer and supports the roof of subclavian triangle. Keeping these points in view, each subdivision of the posterior triangle should be studied with its boundaries and contents in detail. Let's begin with the occipital triangle. Boundaries of occipital triangle are: it almost shares the boundaries of posterior triangle, except that its base is formed by inferior belly of omohyoid and floor is formed by only five muscles, from semispinalis capitis to scalenus medius muscle. Contents of occipital triangle are classified into nerves and arteries. Nerves seen in the occipital triangle are spinal accessory nerve, C3-C4 spinal nerves, and dorsal scapular nerve. Arteries are occipital artery and transverse cervical artery. Let's see the details of each content of the occipital triangle. Let's begin with the nerves. Spinal accessory nerve. It's a part of accessory nerve, which is 11th cranial nerve. Here the image is coronal section of vertebral column in the cervical region, showing a part of brainstem and spinal cord. The accessory nerve arises as two components, cranial component and spinal component. Cranial component arises from medulla oblongata as multiple rootlets, which unite to form a common trunk. Spinal component arises from upper 4 or 5 spinal cord segments. Each segment gives off one or two rootlets, which unite with the adjacent rootlets to form a common trunk, which ascends within the vertebral canal towards foramen magnum, through which it enters into posterior cranial fossa, where it unites with the cranial component to form accessory nerve. The accessory nerve leaves the cranial cavity through jugular foramen along with vagus nerve and glossopharyngeal nerve. Once it enters the base of skull, it divides into two nerves, cranial accessory nerve and spinal accessory nerve, which means the formative components of accessory nerve become distributing nerves. The cranial accessory nerve merge with the vagus nerve and supply the structures along with the vagus. It acts as accessory to vagus nerve, whereas spinal accessory nerve descends laterally deep to the sternocleidomastoid muscle, where it supplies the muscle and enters into posterior triangle at the middle of posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle. It leaves the triangle by passing deep to the trapezius muscle and ends by supplying it, which means the spinal accessory nerve carries motor innervation to only two muscles, sternocleidomastoid muscle and trapezius, by passing deep to these muscles. It lies 5 cm above the clavicle, while it leaves the posterior triangle deep to the trapezius. The point where spinal accessory nerve enters into posterior triangle at the middle of posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle, it is related with 4 cutaneous nerves and superficial cervical lymph nodes, where the nerve is plastered to the overlying investing layer of deep cervical fascia, which is forming the roof. Within the triangle, the nerve passes obliquely downwards and laterally by resting on the underlying levator scapulae muscle. But it is separated from the muscle by underlying prevertebral layer of deep cervical fascia, which is forming the floor, which means the nerve passes between investing layer above and prevertebral layer below, whereas the rest of the contents in the posterior triangle are seen deep to the prevertebral layer within the floor, which is why the spinal accessory nerve is known as genuine content of the posterior triangle, as it lies between the facial roof and facial floor, whereas the rest of the contents lie deep to the facial floor. C3-C4 spinal nerves. Here is the spinal accessory nerve running on the levator scapulae muscle. Here are the ventral rami of C3 and C4 spinal nerves. They run below and parallel to the spinal accessory nerve, but lie deep to the prevertebral fascia. They carry muscular fibers from cervical plexus and end by supplying levator scapulae and trapezius muscles. Dorsal scapular nerve. It's a branch from roots of brachial plexus having the root value of C5. Let's identify the structures in this image. Here is the spinal accessory nerve, and here are the ventral rami of C3 and C4 spinal nerves resting on levator scapulae muscle. Below that is the scalenus medius muscle. Dorsal scapular nerve enters the posterior triangle by piercing the scalenus medius muscle. It has a short course within the triangle It leaves the triangle by passing deep to the levator scapulae and enters onto the back towards scapular region, where it is accompanied laterally by dorsal scapular artery. Both the structures run deep to the rhomboid muscles and end by supplying these muscles. That is about the nerves seen in occipital triangle. The highest nerve seen in the triangle is spinal accessory nerve, below and parallel to which ventral rami of C3 and C4 spinal nerves run on the levator scapulae muscle. Dorsal scapular nerve has a short course seen by piercing the scalenus medius muscle. Occasionally, the C5 root of brachial plexus before forming the upper trunk may be seen as a content within the occipital triangle between scalenus medius muscle and inferior belly of homo hyoid. Coming to the arteries of occipital triangle. Occipital artery, it's an occasional content of the occipital triangle, seen at the apex, resting on semispinalis capitis muscle. It is the only content of the triangle seen above the spinal accessory nerve. Occipital artery is a branch of external carotid artery given off in the anterior triangle. It leaves the anterior triangle by passing deep to the sternocleidomastoid muscle and enters into the apex of occipital triangle. It leaves the occipital triangle by passing deep to the trapezius muscle. Then it pierces the trapezius muscle and becomes superficial, where it shows tortuosity and run towards the posterior part of the scalp and ends by supplying the scalp tissues. Transverse cervical artery or superficial cervical artery. It's a branch of thyrocervical trunk, which in turn is a branch of first part of subclavian artery. Initially, the course of transverse cervical artery may be seen within the subclavian triangle. It enters into the occipital triangle by passing deep to the inferior belly of homo hyoid muscle. It runs superficial to the brachial plexus across the floor of the triangle. Usually, it ends deep to the trapezius muscle by anastomosing with the descending branch of occipital artery. Occasionally, the transverse cervical artery may continue as dorsal scapular artery that we will see in subclavian triangle. That is about the contents of occipital triangle. They are classified into nerves and arteries. Nerves are spinal accessory nerve, ventral rami of C3, C4 spinal nerves and dorsal scapular nerve. Arteries are occipital artery seen at the apex and transverse cervical artery seen at the base of occipital triangle. So that is about the occipital triangle with its boundaries and contents in detail. Let's move on to subclavian triangle. Its boundaries are, in front it is bounded by posterior border of clavicular head of sternocleidomastoid muscle, above and behind by inferior belly of homo hyoid muscle. Apex lies above where the two muscles meet. Base lies below, formed by middle one third of the clavicle. Its roof is formed by skin, superficial fascia with platysma muscle and investing layer of deep cervical fascia. It is related with intermediate branch of supraclavicular nerve and pierced by external jugular vein 2.5 cm above the clavicle. Deep to the investing layer, roof is supported by homo hyoid fascia. Coming to the floor, it is formed by prevertebral fascia and two muscles. They are scalenus medius muscle and deeper in plane, first digitation of serratus anterior muscle supported by outer border of first rib, which means scalenus medius muscle forms the floor of occipital triangle as well as subclavian triangle. Contents of subclavian triangle. They are classified into nerves, arteries, veins and lymph nodes. Nerves seen in the triangle are trunks of brachial plexus, branches of brachial plexus from its roots and upper trunk. Arteries seen are third part of subclavian artery, dorsal scapular artery and suprascapular artery. Veins are subclavian vein with its tributaries. Lymph nodes seen in the subclavian triangle are supraclavicular lymph nodes. Let's see the details of each content of subclavian triangle. Let's begin with the nerves seen in subclavian triangle. Trunks of brachial plexus. Brachial plexus is a nerve plexus formed by ventral rami of C5 to T1 spinal nerves. In relation with the clavicle, brachial plexus can be divided into two parts anatomically, upper supraclavicular part and lower infraclavicular part. Supraclavicular part is seen in the neck region, whereas infraclavicular part seen in the axilla. Supraclavicular part consists of roots and trunks. Roots are nothing but ventral rami of C5 to T1 spinal nerves. C5 and C6 roots unite to form upper trunk. C7 root continues as middle trunk. And C8, T1 roots unite to form lower trunk. Which means, what we see in the subclavian triangle is upper, middle and lower trunks of brachial plexus. They emerge into the subclavian triangle between scalenus medius and scalenus anterior. Branches of brachial plexus from its roots. Here is the scalenus medius and here is the scalenus anterior muscle, which can be visualized after reflecting the clavicular head of sternocleidomastoid muscle. Between the scalenus medius and anterior, brachial plexus emerge into the subclavian triangle. On the anterior surface of scalenus anterior, a nerve descends known as phrenic nerve with the root value C3, C4, C5. It is the C5 root from the brachial plexus gives a twig in the formation of phrenic nerve. However, phrenic nerve is not considered as a content of subclavian triangle, as it lies deep to the clavicular head of sternocleidomastoid muscle along with the scalenus anterior. The other branch coming from the roots of brachial plexus seen in the subclavian triangle is long thoracic nerve with the root value C5, C6, C7, which means it receives three rootlets from the brachial plexus. The three rootlets of long thoracic nerve enter into subclavian triangle after piercing the scalenus medius muscle just below the dorsal scapular nerve, which we have seen in the occipital triangle. So here is the C5 rootlet, C6 rootlet and C7 rootlet, which enters into subclavian triangle after piercing the scalenus medius muscle below the dorsal scapular nerve. They run over the first digitation of serratus anterior muscle, which forms the floor of the subclavian triangle. There they supply the muscle. Below, they unite to form a common trunk, which run on the outer surface of rest of the serratus anterior muscle on the lateral thoracic wall and ends by supplying the muscle. So the long thoracic nerve is a branch of roots of brachial plexus seen in the subclavian triangle deep to the brachial plexus. Branches of brachial plexus from the upper trunk. Let's identify the colored structures in this image. Here are the scalenus medius and scalenus anterior muscles. Between these two, brachial plexus emerge into the subclavian triangle. Here are the C5 and C6 roots of brachial plexus, which unite to form upper trunk. Upper trunk further divides into ventral and dorsal divisions. In the subclavian triangle, upper trunk gives off two branches. They are nerve to subclavius, which run downwards and medially leave the subclavian triangle by passing deep to the clavicle. It ends by supplying the subclavius muscle. The other branch coming from the upper trunk is suprascapular nerve, which run downwards and laterally leave the subclavian triangle by passing deep to the trapezius muscle. From there, it enters onto the scapular region by passing deep to the transverse scapular ligament through suprascapular notch. There it is accompanied by suprascapular artery. It enters into supraspinous fossa. There it supplies the supraspinatus muscle. Then it enters into infraspinous fossa. There it supplies the infraspinatus muscle and also few articular twigs to shoulder joint and acromioclavicular joint. Nerve to subclavius and suprascapular nerve They share common root value as they are branches of upper trunk, that is C5 and C6. Upper trunk of the brachial plexus is vulnerable for injuries. It is also known as Earp's point, where the six nerves meet. They are C5-C6 roots, ventral and dorsal divisions of upper trunk, and two branches of upper trunk. Now to subclavius and suprascapular nerve. That is about the nerves seen in subclavian triangle. They are trunks of brachial plexus, branches of brachial plexus, from the roots long thoracic nerve, from the upper trunk suprascapular nerve, and now to subclavius. Moving on to the arteries seen in subclavian triangle. Here are the scalenus medius and scalenus anterior muscles, with the brachial plexus between these two muscles entering into subclavian triangle. The major artery seen in the subclavian triangle is subclavian artery. The course of the artery can be divided into three parts in relation with scalenus anterior muscle, into first part, second part, and third part. First part of the artery lies medial to the muscle, second part deep to the muscle, and third part lateral to the muscle. It is the third part of subclavian artery seen as a content in the subclavian triangle. In the triangle, artery lies superficial to the brachial plexus and runs over the upper surface of first rib, lodging in subclavian groove. From there, it leaves the triangle by passing deep to the clavicle and continue as axillary artery below into the axilla. Within the triangle, it gives off a branch known as dorsal scapular artery, which passes between the trunks of brachial plexus and leave the triangle by passing deep to the trapezius muscle. The other artery seen in the subclavian triangle is suprascapular artery, which is a branch of thyrocervical trunk, which in turn is a branch of first part of subclavian artery. Thyrocervical trunk gives off three branches: suprascapular artery, transverse cervical artery or superficial cervical artery, which enters into the occipital triangle. The third branch is inferior thyroid artery, which supplies the thyroid gland. Let's see the further course of dorsal scapular artery and suprascapular artery. Here is the suprascapular artery coming from thyrocervical trunk. After leaving the subclavian triangle, it passes over the scapular region above the transverse scapular ligament, accompanied by suprascapular nerve. It enters into the supraspinous fossa, supplies the supraspinatus muscle. Then it enters into the infraspinous fossa. There it supplies the infraspinatus muscle. It also gives off anastomotic branches to form the anastomosis around the scapula. The dorsal scapular artery, which is a branch of third part of subclavian artery, or it may be continuation of transverse cervical artery. It enters onto the scapular region after leaving the subclavian triangle. It passes over the superior angle of the scapula, then runs along the medial border of scapula, accompanied by dorsal scapular nerve. Both the structures lie deep to the rhomboid muscles and end by supplying the rhomboids. Coming to the veins, the major vein seen in the subclavian triangle is subclavian vein. It begins as a continuation of axillary vein at the outer border of first rib. It passes over the upper surface of the first rib, lodging in the subclavian groove. There it lies antero-inferior to the subclavian artery, from which it is separated by scalenus anterior muscle. The vein arches medially, unites with internal jugular vein, and forms brachiocephalic vein. Within the subclavian triangle, the subclavian vein receives a tributary external jugular vein, which pierces the roof of the subclavian triangle 2.5 cm above the clavicle. Before the external jugular vein opens into subclavian vein, it receives three tributaries. They are transverse cervical vein, suprascapular vein, and anterior jugular vein. So the veins seen in the subclavian triangle are subclavian vein, its tributary external jugular vein, its three tributaries transverse cervical, suprascapular and anterior jugular veins. Lymph nodes seen in the subclavian triangle are supraclavicular lymph nodes. They are one of the deep cervical lymph nodes situated posteroinferiorly in the lateral side of the neck. In the subclavian triangle, they lie below the inferior belly of omohyoid, superficial to the other contents, between the facial roof and facial floor of the triangle. They receive afferents from superior group of deep cervical lymph nodes, axillary group of lymph nodes, and deltopectoral group of lymph nodes. Efferents from the supraclavicular lymph nodes form jugular lymph trunk. Along with the subclavian lymph trunk, it opens into thoracic duct on the left side and right lymphatic duct on the right side. That is about the contents seen in subclavian triangle. The points to be remember here are, nerves and arteries in the subclavian triangle lie deep to the prevertebral fascia, whereas veins and lymph nodes are more superficial. They lie between facial roof and facial floor. That is about the subclavian triangle with its boundaries and contents in detail. So the posterior triangle lies behind the sternocleidomastoid muscle, divided into two triangles, upper larger occipital triangle and lower smaller subclavian or supraclavicular triangle by inferior belly of omohyoid muscle. Each subdivision of the posterior triangle should be studied with its boundaries and contents in detail. Let's quickly revise the nerves seen in the posterior triangle in this dissected cadaver, which is showing left-sided posterior triangle. Here is the trapezius muscle, here is the levator scapulae, here is the scalenus medius, and here is the scalenus anterior muscles. Nerves seen in the occipital triangle are spinal accessory nerve, which is the highest content in the occipital triangle. Below and parallel to it, ventral rami of C3 and C4 spinal nerves. The nerve piercing the scalenus medius will be dorsal scapular nerve. Coming to the subclavian triangle, nerves seen in the subclavian triangle are trunks of brachial plexus. Here are the roots of brachial plexus, which are nothing but ventral rami of C5 to T1. C5, C6 roots unite to form upper trunk here. C7 continues as middle trunk. C8 and T1 roots unite to form lower trunk here. Branches from the brachial plexus coming from the roots are long thoracic nerve, which receives C5, C6, C7 rootlets and lies deep to the brachial plexus. Enters into the subclavian triangle by piercing the scalenus medius muscle below the dorsal scapular nerve. The other branch from the roots of brachial plexus is phrenic nerve, which lies in front of scalenus anterior muscle, but it is not considered as a content of subclavian triangle. Branches from the upper trunk of brachial plexus are suprascapular nerve, which run downwards and laterally, now to subclavius, which run downwards and medially. Arteries seen in the posterior triangle are occipital artery, transverse cervical artery, which are the contents of occipital triangle, third part of subclavian artery, dorsal scapular artery, and suprascapular artery, which are the contents of subclavian triangle. Now it's time to see the clinical aspects. Torticollis or wry neck. It is defined as shortening of sternocleidomastoid muscle causing tilting or twisting of the head towards affected side and chin pointed towards opposite side. It can be congenital or acquired. Congenital torticollis, it is usually due to stretching of the muscle because of extreme rotation of head of the fetus during difficult labor, which leads to tearing of its muscle fibers and intravascular venous blood clotting deep to the muscle, causing fibrosis and shortening of the muscle. In acquired torticollis, there will be repeated painful spasmodic contractions of sternocleidomastoid muscle and trapezius muscle on one side, which is why it is also known as spasmodic torticollis. It is usually due to exposure to extreme cold or maladjustment of pillows during night or psychogenic. At the middle of posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle, there are multiple nerves which are emerging into posterior triangle. Four cutaneous nerves and spinal accessory nerve. The point where these nerves diverge is called as nerve point of the neck. It has a surgical relevance. In case of a subcutaneous abscess at the middle of posterior border of sternocleidomastoid muscle, the surgical incision should be given superficially to avoid injury to these nerves, particularly the spinal accessory nerve. Spinal accessory nerve is the highest content seen in the posterior triangle, as the occipital artery is an occasional content seen in the triangle. Depending on the course of the nerve, posterior triangle can be divided into two surgical zones, upper carefree zone and lower careful zone, which means in upper carefree zone, there are no contents seen in the triangle. In the lower careful zone, rest of the contents, nerves, vessels and lymph nodes are seen in the posterior triangle. Here the image is showing ventral view of cervical vertebrae with few prevertebral muscles. The prevertebral muscles seen in the posterior triangle are three scalene muscles. Here is the posterior scalene, middle scalene and anterior scalene. Between the middle and anterior scalene muscles, brachial plexus and subclavian artery enter into subclavian triangle. The gap between these two muscles is known as interscalene triangle, through which contents of subclavian triangle leave the posterior triangle, enter into axilla. While the brachial plexus and subclavian artery lie deep to the prevertebral fascia in the subclavian triangle, they carry a part of prevertebral fascia in the form of a tubular expansion into the axilla. Such tubular fascia is known as axillary sheath, which does not include the subclavian vein or axillary vein, as it lies superficial to the prevertebral fascia between facial roof and facial floor. Occasionally, the transverse process of C7 vertebra may extend towards the first rib and gets attached to the upper surface of first rib by a bony process or through a fibrous tissue. Such abnormal extended bony process is known as cervical rib. It can be unilateral or bilateral. The anterior end of the bone extend into the interscalene triangle, making the triangle narrow, and it may compress the subclavian artery, causing ischemia to the upper limb. Further, artery shows dilatation distal to the obstruction. As the brachial plexus also seen in the interscalene triangle, the cervical rib may compress the brachial plexus from below at the lower trunk, causing clumcase palsy. Virchow's nodes. They are enlarged supraclavicular lymph nodes seen in the left subclavian triangle. It's a common finding seen in the malignancy of stomach or testis or any other viscera of the abdomen. Here is the end of this video with the detailed gross anatomy of posterior triangle of neck. Thank you for your patient listening. Keep learning.